Hello, BookTube. This is Terry with Terry Talks Books, and I am here to do a December 2019 wrap-up. This video will focus primarily on the reading that I did for Cloak & Dagger Christmas, but I will also add in some of my other reading at the end of the video, because I didn't stick to just the mystery reading for that reading event. So I really enjoyed this. I really enjoyed Cloak & Dagger, and I will link some information about that below in case you don't know what that was. And I encourage you to join next year. If you didn't do it this year, join next year. It was a lot of fun, especially if you're one of those people like I am. I really like to read mysteries during the winter months. I'm not sure why, but it's one of my preferred seasonal readings, types of reading that I like to do. And mysteries in the winter just for some reason makes sense to me. So let's get started here, because I have quite a few books. Cloak & Dagger had six prompts for that. And I'm going to read the prompt and then tell you the book that I chose and whether I read it or not. And if I did read it, a little bit about that. So the first one is O Tannenbaum, a translated book. And that was Pieter the Latvian by Georges Simenon. This is translated from the French by David Bellos. This I did not get to, and I am very sad about that. And it's too bad, because it wasn't, I just couldn't fit it in. I didn't want to, at 11 p.m. on December 31st, I really didn't want to be just trying to pack in another book just to say I did it. So this will go back in the TBR pile and hopefully be read soon. This is the first book. Magret novel, so maybe you saw the PBS? It was a British, I think a British show, Magret, and Inspector Magret. So I would actually like to get to this fairly soon. I hope I do. I say that about a lot of books. The second prompt is, I Saw Three Ships, a book set in a location you don't normally read about. The one I chose for that is Drive Your Plow Over the Bones of the Dead by Olga Tokarczuk. I'm not sure if that's correct pronunciation or not. I'm guessing. And this was translated from the Polish by Antonia Lloyd-Jones. Antonia Lloyd-Jones, she translated this. And this takes place in a village in Poland on the border with the Czech Republic. And I do not read too many books set in that location. I'm not sure if I've read any books set in that location, so this fit that prompt. Now, I read this book in November, so on my TBR, I indicated that this is something that I was recommending to you all, as opposed to a book I was reading. I didn't actually read for this prompt, since I just finished this, days before this event started. So I know it's a little bit of a cop-out, but this was really good. I really enjoyed this. This is it has a lot of dark humor, and it does ask some pretty big questions. There's a character, our main character, is what I like to call a warped Miss Marple. There's a lot in this book that is rather warped, but in a very humorous way. So it is a mystery. It is a mystery. There is a crime to be solved. There's some commentary about animal rights, animal welfare. So if that's one of your things, you might also enjoy this. If you don't like dark humor, though, you might not like this. I don't know. I have a very cracked sense of humor, so I liked it. One of the things, I'm just going to read you inside on the flap here. I thought it said more than I could probably say. A deeply satisfying thriller come fairy tale. Drive Your Plow Over the Bones of the Dead is a provocative exploration of the murky borderland between sanity and madness. It does ask that question, what is crazy? And is our character crazy? Who are the crazy people here? The murky borderland between sanity and madness, justice and tradition, autonomy and fate. Whom do we deem sane? It asks. Who is worthy of a voice? So you can see underneath it all, it's asking some pretty interesting questions, and then comments on those in the form of a story. And it did feel kind of fairy tale like in many ways too. So I will read this again. That's usually how I can tell you whether, you know, how much I liked a book or not. You know, do I want to read it again? Was there something there that is prompting me to, I want to come back to it, you know? And I do want to read this again. So this will go on my shelf and someday I'll pick that up and read it all over again. Let's see, prompt number 3, Silent Night, a story with an unknown adversary. And for that, I chose yet another translated work. It wasn't required, but several of mine ended up that way. I chose A Quiet Place by Seicho Matsumoto. And this is translated from the Japanese by Louise Hill Kauai. I did not get to this book. Again, oh, I really wanted to get to this book. And I kind of, since I didn't get to the Simenon book, this one here, I want to read these two together because there was something in the blurbage here about Seicho Matsumoto being the Japanese Georges Simenon. So I kind of want to read them side by side to see if I can pick up on why somebody would say that. You know, what are the similarities there? So I did not get to this one either. Darn it. Just so many good books to read. So that too is going back on the TBR stack. The fourth prompt, In the Bleak Midwinter, a story set in a cold climate or one that makes your blood run cold. And for that, I read The Winter People by Jennifer McMahon. There we go. And the cover looks cold. The setting also was a very cold setting. A lot of snow, a lot of cold weather, a lot of people running around out in that cold weather. It also did... Okay, I will say that it did make my blood run cold for part of the book. And I was a bit disappointed in this book, unfortunately. I had high hopes, and it was, you know, it had all these things that I would like. It had, you know, secrets, and it had history, you know, people finding, you know, diaries from someone in the past, and, you know, a mystery that comes out from the past and haunts the people in the present day, so to speak. This book had, it started out as a pretty decent historical thriller, modern day psychological thriller, with some great possible supernatural aspects to it. And then the last, I can't remember if it was the last third of the book, the last half of the book, just devolved into what I thought of as a bad 1970s zombie movie plot. So I was very, very disappointed, and darn, I wanted to like this more than I did. I think I gave it 3 stars out of 5 anyway, because the first half of the book was very entertaining for me and it had great possibilities, and the setting was, you know, I enjoyed the setting and all of that, but it's almost like two people wrote the book. I'm not sure what happened there. So anyway, there was that one. Then the 5th prompt was, I Heard the Bells on Christmas Day, a mystery involving Christmas. And for that one, I'd chosen Silent Nights, Christmas Mysteries from the British Library Crime Classics. And this is something, this was a collection of short stories, Christmas-related short stories. Again, I did not get to this one. So that's 3 that I did not get to for this. I didn't even read any out of this. The Blue Carbuncle by Sir Arthur Conan Doyle is the first story, and I'd read that previously, so I guess you could say I read one story, but I didn't read any for this event, but I've read one that's in here. So I will have to just try to come back to this again in the future. There are so many wonderful authors in here. G.K. Chesterton. I noticed Marjorie Allingham, Dorothy Sayers, Edmund Crispin. If you know who he is, you'll know why I'm kind of excited about one of his stories being in here. So, and others. I just, you know, I didn't get to it. Great cover. Had a great Christmas cover. Yeah. Anyway. Okay, the sixth prompt. And the reason some of these didn't get done is because I really wanted to make sure this one got in there. Come, thou long-expected Jesus, read a mystery you've been wanting to read for a while. In this case, for a very long while. And I read The Cruelest Month by Louise Penny. I finally read it, guys. This one, I think I've told you guys before, but I read Still Life, the first in the Inspector Gamache Three Pines mystery series. Still Life was the first one, and I read that when it came out. So what was the year for that? Probably 2006, maybe. I'm not sure the date of that book, but it was around 2006 and I read it right away. No, this one's the third book, so it would have been even earlier than that, 2004, 2005. Anyway, it goes way, way back. So I read that and I went, wow, I really liked that. So as soon as the second book came out, which was probably 2006, I read that one. That was A Fatal Grace. Read that, loved it, and then started picking the rest of them up as they came out and got behind in my reading, as you do, especially with series, and kept collecting them, but I stalled out at number three, which was terrible because I really like this series and I knew, you know, from reading the first two that I was going to love these. So this has been sitting around. This has a copyright date, 2007. 2007 is the copyright date on this. So I have had this since 2007, 2008, and hadn't read it. So I read it, and guess what? I loved it. I didn't love this one as much as number one and number two, but I liked it a lot. So, and that's just, these are like fine points. When you read a series, you know how that is with series, you know, it's like, well, the series as a whole, you'll say it's like a four or a five, and you just love it. And then the individual books are, you know, some of them are better than others, some of them you just, they're not necessarily better, but you like them better than others. So this was just one that I didn't like it as much as the first two, but again, super fine point. I really liked it anyway. So this one takes place in around Easter, and there is a seance, and someone dies, and so there's a lot of kind of supernatural, you know, possibilities there. And so then we have to figure out, get to solve the crime with all of the wonderful characters. And if you've read these, you'll know what I mean by that. Just, there's a lot of quirky characters, and I love them all. I just love them all. I really got a kick out of, what was her, the crazy lady's name? Ooh, I should have written that down. Nora? Not Nora. Nora's not right. Anyway, in this book, she takes on some little ducklings. If you've read it, you'll know that. You'll know what I'm talking about. And they follow her around, and so she appears to be this crazy lady. She's a poet as well. And she's a very good poet, but she comes off as rather crazy and rude and misanthropic. And so she's in this book, she's got these little ducklings following her around. I'm not seeing her name. I keep wanting to say Zora or Nora or something like that. And, okay, well, I don't want to belabor that too much. Anyway, I'm not giving you too much here. Really, I'm not. Read it. I finally read it. I loved it. If you haven't read this series, you should pick it up and read it. If you like a mystery that is rather, it's cozy, but somewhat gritty and very quirky, and I would consider these fairly literary as well. It just is this amazing, amazingly well-rounded series, I thought. And I read it pretty quickly. Read it pretty quickly. Loved it. Okay, let's see. The extra. There was a read along. And I don't know if it was officially part of Cloak and Dagger or if this was separate. I don't know. I don't recall. But there was a read along of The Trembling Hills by Phyllis A. Whitney. Here's my copy. And this is a book that was published in the 1950s, 1955, 1956, something like that. 1956. So this is actually an older book, and it's kind of romantic. It's got some romance. There's definitely a mystery. I don't know what you would consider this author. Gothic romance mystery, historical. Anyway, this book takes place during 1906, and the San Francisco earthquake and fire. Okay, now I told you guys a story, and I said there was a book that I read when I was quite young, maybe 10 years old or so. So, a very long time ago, checked it out from my library, my school library, and it was about the San Francisco earthquake and fire. It was a piece of fiction, and I remember it being mass market sized, and I have just kind of a vague possible image for the book cover. It's not real clear, but there was something when I read the synopsis for this that made me wonder. It was a book that I'd read and I got about two-thirds through, maybe, and the book was due. I had to return it and couldn't check it back out for some reason. I don't remember what that was. And I was right in the middle of it and I was really enjoying it. And I didn't remember what that title was. I didn't remember who the author was, but these books by Phyllis Whitney would have been, especially this one with its topic, kind of historical topic, would have been one that would have been in my school library, and that school library covered, K through 8. So this would have been something maybe over where, for the 8th graders, and I was always rummaging around in the books for the older kids. So anyway, it always bugged me, and I've never forgotten that there was this book, and I was really enjoying it. And here's the topic. Gee, how would I ever track that down? I'd kind of like to see, how that went, and what it was I was reading. Well, when I was looking at the synopsis on this, I thought, that sounds like it might be the book, and this would totally be something that would be in a library way back then for, for 8th graders to read. So it is not a YA book in any way, shape, or form that I, could tell. It's just, that's, just was how we did our reading back then. We didn't really have YA books, and it was something that an 8th grader could read, and there was nothing in it that an 8th grader shouldn't read. So anyway, I am happy to report that I think I found my book. Real life mystery, book found. There were a few scenes in here, and namely, I had this image of two people sitting on the stairs talking, and one of them was a child, a little girl, and that this was a place from which the kids, or like the governess, so to speak, might sit and watch the goings on of the upper class, homeowners, the people who live there. And, if they'd be having parties downstairs, that they would could sit up there, and they could, kind of spy on them and see what was going on. So I had some images, and that was one of them. And I was trying to be very careful, and I think I matched up enough of the images that I had in my head and feel really certain that this was the book I was reading. There were just too many things that lined up here. So I really enjoyed it too. I really did enjoy this, and I got to finish it. It was a wonderful, sweet in some ways. There's all sorts of things in here. There's, some social commentary. There's, the history of the San Francisco fire and the earthquake and then the fire. And the people who lived in the wealthy people who lived in the big Victorian homes, up on the hills, and then there were the others, the immigrants and others who lived in, you know, like shanties, and many of them in the lowlands along the docks and things like that. And it was just a terrible, terrible event. It was just a terrible, there was death and utter destruction. And we have a crazy, there's a mystery. We've got kind of a crazy, not crazy, but she's a kind of a monster of a matriarch in one of the families. And she's, you know, always trying to manipulate people and run their lives. Yeah, again, I'm not really giving you too much here, but it was, some mysteries are solved, and, you know, there's unknown parentage, there's, they call it a wicked matriarch nursing a strange and unfathomable vengeance in her Knob Hill mansion. Yeah, we've got a lot of gothic atmosphere going on in these mansions with all this dark wood and so we've got the crazy lady, not the crazy lady, the rather wicked, monstrously wicked matriarch. And then I keep saying crazy lady because there is a possibility of, you know, something like a Jane Eyre situation where you've got, oops, I just gave that, I'm gonna, about to give that away. Don't listen if you haven't read Jane Eyre. Okay. The crazy lady locked in the attic kind of situation, you know, the ex-wife, one of those situations. So we're trying to find out if that happened or not. I'm not telling you whether it did or not, but you have the possibility of that being there. And then there's this mysterious cat, but is it really something supernatural, you know? And of course, some of the great gothic imagery, you know, faces coming out, you know, like they seem to be floating, you know, down the hallway, and it's because it's dark and they're carrying a candle and all you see is their face, right? So, but all that kind of imagery. So if you're into that, you'll probably love this. Personal life mystery solved. The Trembling Hills. I'm going to say that's what I was reading when I was 10. Pretty darn sure of it. Loved it then. Loved it this time. And that's a huge age gap, and I still really enjoyed it. So that's saying a lot. So have fun reading that one. Then what else did I read? Seemed like, I'm missing something. See if I can see what it is I'm missing. This one here. Okay. Some other reading that I had in the stack for Christmas. I had two specifically Christmas books I wanted to read. And this one I just picked up, and I'm going to go ahead and read it here in January. This is A Christmas at Fairacre by Miss Reed. Covering up her name. Miss Reed, not her real name. But they're just charming. They're charming stories. I'm not very far in, you can see, but it's wonderful, charming, takes place at Christmas. And so I wanted to get that read in December, didn't, but I am reading it now. It's a rather fast read. Then I almost always pick up what I call a Hallmark movie type book to read at Christmas. I just get in the mood. I just want kind of a completely not real life romance that takes place in a Christmas and wintry setting. So I read Alaskan Holiday by Debbie McComber, and it is pretty much what you would expect from a Hallmark movie type book. A romance. We've got a remote Alaskan town. We've got a woman who goes up there. She's going to be, she's working at a kind of a resort lodge up there in Alaska, and she's there for 6 months. It doesn't stay open all year long, and she is the chef, and she has a really big deal job back in Oregon that she is supposed to go to after she finishes up here. A famous chef is opening a restaurant, and so she has to make a decision once she's met somebody up here in Alaska. She loves him, but does she really want to give up her big opportunity for this chef career to stay in Alaska and marry this guy who does, what did he do, woodworking? Was it woodworking? Oh no, he makes swords. He makes swords, that's right. So anyway, she has to make this decision. And it's, you know, it ends up just about how you'd think, you know, trauma, trauma, trauma. Okay, we leave, you know, we go down to Oregon, and then we have to make a decision, you know, blah, blah, you know. And there's some great quirky characters in here, too. So, and the setting is wonderful. It's in Alaska, so you've got all the cold weather, and some of it takes place over Christmas. And so we get a little bit of Christmas vibe. Not much else to tell you. I enjoyed it. It's one of those 3-star reads that I enjoyed that I'll pass on to somebody else. So had fun with that. And then the last thing I'm going to mention is the stories of John Cheever. I did not read this in December alone, let me tell you, because it's over 700 pages, almost 700 pages. It's almost 700 pages. It is all the stories of John Cheever in order. And it covers the 1940s through the 70s, I do believe, is what it covered. And as short story collections go, this is, you know, you like some more than you like others. And that was the case here. I love Cheever's writing. I really do. I think that many of the stories in here, they felt to me like writing exercises. And they didn't have that short story format that I really want. That, you know, like tells a story and you can say what the story was. It's more like characterizations of people, and the people don't make sense to you very often in the decisions they make. And there's not really a beginning. There's not really an end. There's no resolution. Many, many of the stories were like that. And so it drove me kind of nuts. But there were some absolutely brilliant pieces in here as well. And, you know, if you are a fan of John Cheever, I suggest that you read these stories. I think that they will probably tell you something about the author. Definitely you can see some development and practice writing or development of characters and places maybe for his novels. So if you're a completist, if you are interested in John Cheever and reading all of John Cheever's works, you know, then you would definitely want to read these stories. But it wasn't really for me. Short stories in and of themselves are not really my thing. I kind of have to force myself to read them. And I further refined what I do and don't like about short stories by reading this. And I think for me, I like to read, like if it's an anthology, and it can be themed, a themed anthology, but I like to have different authors. Reading too many of the same, catching the glare, there you go. Reading too many stories, one after another, by the same author. For me, at least in this case, I found myself sometimes I kind of had to drag myself to the book to get to read them. You know, I guess I like a little bit more diversity, and I do like more of a short story format that's not what he did here. So anyway, but I read this. This was a buddy read with Joe at the retired, Joe Lisa at the Retired Book Nerd. And we are both very glad that we read this, and we are very glad that we took a year to do it. We read about 5 stories a month. This month there were 6. And we were glad we had an accountability partner, because otherwise neither one of us probably would have finished it, and it would have gone back to the shelf, and maybe or maybe, you know, you don't come back to it. So we're both glad we did read this. And it was, like I said, a year-long project. And I will now move on from that. I do want to go back and read the John Cheever novels that I haven't read, though. I'm still interested in doing that. So anyway, it didn't kill my love for John Cheever. It just taught me something about myself and short stories, for sure. So anyway, that was my December reading. I think I covered it all. If not, oh well. There was a lot of reading, and then a few sad little tomes that are going to go back into a pile to be read in the future. So anyway, I hope that you all are having a wonderful time reading, and that you had a great December and did some great reading. And I'll see you guys in the next video. Talk to you later. Bye-bye.